baptism is. Baptism is done for the forgiveness of sins, Acts 2:38. Baptism is done to save us, 1 Peter 3:21, Acts 2:40, Mark 16:16. Baptism is done to wash away our sins, Acts 22:16. Baptism is done to be reborn to new life, John 3:5, Romans 6:3 6. Baptism is done to clothe ourselves with Christ, Galatians 3:26 and 27.
And somebody else stands up and they give out their own, and then there's another interpretation. But it doesn't coincide, or doesn't just quite fit in with what has already happened. And what I'm talking about is, where do they get this? See, I'm thinking God is the author of confusion. But then you say the death of the gift stirred up. Who's guilt? What's guilt?
Well,
you see, I'm having a hard time with this. I'm having a hard time associating this with God. In other words, let's just say, for instance, you gave out tongues. I mean, he gave out a message last night. And said, when the devil in tongues comes up and he has been used of God before to say this in this deal. And you come up with something.
What did you get that? It's a hard thing that's trying to really be understood in the language, but for example, Paul says he recognized that these gifts would stir up speaking of tongues. You know, that certain anointings would do this. Certain rules of the Spirit. And he said if they did not interpret it, let him keep quiet. Now, he did not deny that the one speaking was speaking in the language of the Holy Ghost. Something stirred that man speak in tongues.
I believe it's been that one. But what I'm talking about is what we're doing now has come up.
Well, there's no difference, really, as I see it, there's no difference in you speaking in tongues and giving out the message and being out of order. And we have found someone to interpret out of order. A lot of human spirit gets involved, but on the other hand, I've seen some silly, unstable people get stirred up. Now, really, mainly what I was referring to was very few times would I say that we get further interpretations, although I've seen it on occasions. What I'm referring to, you'll have a generally, after a mighty move, you'll have a discourse of tongues. Almost invariably, especially if people are not tongued, sometimes it's God. There's maybe more than one message for a service. I've seen two different type messages given in a service for two different people. But you know, what I'm referring to mainly, you know, a lot of this is just human spirit being stirred. And maybe the gift, I've seen people who have the gift in them, but they're not exercising it. They're in the formative stages of the gift. This would stir them up to try to give out something, but it would not necessarily be accurate. And there's a man of God, Mother Davis. I'm going to give out messages that were just very shallow. And when I don't want to be misunderstood here, but they hung over the arm and couldn't assume. I believe that's God. But that's all the faith they had. Bible said prophesy according to the measure of your faith. Now, anybody give out a general message, especially agreeing with the Bible already, the whole line couldn't assume. It don't take much faith to do that. But to get up and say in your pocket, this man is such and such an evil, and call it by name. It takes faith. Now, what I'm saying is a lot of times those that are in the formative stages of operating the gift will give out their little messages. And I'm saying, I don't really believe it necessarily is just flesh. it just does make it new to operate again, because it's not developed to a stage. And God listened to you. I've said great hits, but I couldn't say it wasn't God, because there was no more faith to give out anything but genuine messages. I'm in your midst. I am coming soon. These are wonderful words, and they're true, but it doesn't take any faith to say that. But it takes faith to say, this night is your final call, or behold, this night I have seen the Christians and the ones who are going on. They figure this woman coming so mighty. She says, you said in your bedroom such and such words. The man came to the pastor and said, I said those identical words, not more, not less. And I said them in my bedroom. And I said them to my wife, and she was the only one home. He made this statement, said, if I ever see him, I'm not coming to this church. He said, I look out in the church. Well, that needs to be in our church. Now, some of this is human spirit, that is. No question. That's what the early church is having a problem with, is the lack of self-control. Some are getting blessed, but you can't say it's not the blessing of the Lord. And we've got to learn to control this blessing to fit God's pattern.
For some reason or another, I don't know, I might not be just explaining it just like I feel it and see it, but it's hard for me to comprehend. Maybe it's just because of the Catholicism I still have in it, about this reverencing God and things pertaining to God. But I finally thought I wanted me to conceive to hear a man, not only hear from God, is giving forth a message, and God in turn will let somebody else play with it, so to speak. In my mind, this is the way it is.
Not really, man, Davis. You'll have to, when you pass the church, you'll have more patience with that. They're not really playing the majority of the time. They feel it. They're just trying to obey God. When you're teaching obedience to the Spirit, you're going to have a lot of that. This is a great reason why a lot of preachers do not teach gifts of the Spirit. Almost fighting because of the aftermath and repercussions of it. But you should always have it under control in teaching it. Keeps the order of it. And that doesn't mean these people are not sincere.
I've seen the words, can I say that this is just like a child with his first bicycle?
Yeah, when a child's sincere, they're trying to ride it.
it's fun, yeah.
Well, in other words, don't look at it from the standpoint of somebody trying to necessarily get in the limelight. Now, this will happen. But I say that, Brother Davis, this happens in the minority of the cases, not the majority. There are a few people in the fifth move of God, and it doesn't make any difference. If the warning comes really from a message, whether it's blessing or curse, it always brings a certain fear, or a certain reverence, shall I say. Now, I had to call them out. And they were sincere people. I was in one place, and the Spirit spoke to me that God was going to use a pastor to prophesy. The Spirit was settling. As a result of the Spirit that was settling, this woman screamed out. It was moving, and she was a clean woman. She just did not know reason. And she began to scream out in tongues and try to interpret. Well, it was not according to wisdom. Her human spirit got beside self because of what she felt in God. I mean, don't charge just the saint. The preacher gets in that fix. He gets to preaching under the anointing, and if he's not careful, he'll go beyond that anointing. Feeling so good the anointing, he'll go about 30 minutes beyond it, and he's just coasting on what he felt. Well, he's just as much in the flesh as that one found out where he's good. He's enjoyed it so much. I've known it. Meanwhile, I've been feeling so good over this anointing, till I try to scratch it out, none. And you do too. You know what you said. But this particular woman, I finally said, sister, if you want to do all that screaming, honor, go in the back room, please. Well, she was so lost in the spirit, so she didn't hear me. When they get too spiritual, they hear the pulpit, they're too spiritual. So I asked the pastor's wife to go get her, you know. And she did. The last time I remember, she was just a carrying on. when she left on out, sure enough. Now, I hadn't told anybody what I felt. I just knew God was fixing to work. The pastor come up from there with a cross and make your hair stand nice, but it won't do him. Well, this premature woman, I don't think even had the gift, really. But I don't think she was playing. I think she was seriously trying to obey what she felt. And this is where you're running the problems, teaching. Come on, saints, you live in the Spirit. And then you say, uh-uh. So you've got to teach them that there's a balance to it all. I have a little man up here in the pole, and she'll have a reason why you've got a balance. There's nothing that needs more balance than the operation of the Spirit. People get too far out. And a lot of this you're talking about, Brother Davis, is a product of human spirit being affected by the Spirit of God. And we get into the lesson, we implant in our human spirit and its reaction. Having been stirred by the Spirit of God, the human spirit takes over and goes beyond the will of God. That's what the Corinthian church had a problem with. You've got to teach saints the difference. And they're feeling such a mighty move on one hand. The reaction would be to turn loose to something that would really be more of a human spirit. It doesn't have to be an interpretation. It can be just tones of blessing. Somebody speak out a message and they start hollering and screaming and shouting. Wait a minute, buddy. Well, I don't believe it, but when you go to fill it up, but they didn't know how to control the flow of God. You know, electricity is electricity. I don't care what you put it. Power of God is the power of God, and I don't care what you put it. But if you can train people to use it, it can be nice for a life of good. But on the other hand, some folks don't know how to use it and harness it. And it can go wild.
But do you not control something that you don't experience yourself? Like, so you never had a gift of prophecy. And you got a church and...
Well, I'm not going to sound smart, but I'm going to just answer me this way, brother. Maybe why not have to have had the gift of doctrine? So by learning from God's word, whether you want to operate this or not, you can learn how it's supposed to be operated. And I think every pastor should know this. Or any preacher should know this at all times before they can put their hand on whatever needs to be controlled. The great problem in illness is not fear of wildfire. Everybody knows that as a result, the aftermath of the will of God is creates, well, in a number of conditions. As I mentioned tonight, it sounds like I'm just talking in circles, but really, any number of conditions can follow the will of God. Human spirits can be stirred up. And persons who are in the process of developing gifts can be stirred up not knowing how to handle that gift. Or sometimes, as an aftermath, the real man will come on me. For example, if you are a preacher and you're sitting listening to a preacher, and that preacher is mighty the will of God, you know what's going to happen to you? You're going to feel an anointing come on you that'll make you want to preach. You'd almost wish you'd go out of your way where you can help. Or you'd almost, if thoughts will come to you, other messages will come, would they not? Maybe you don't understand what he's talking about, but he provoked thoughts in your mind because of your anointing. Now, the same thing happens to that saint. They just don't know how to control it. You know how to control it. You know that you can get up and say, hold it, Mr. God, my message. You wait your time. That's what the Bible I was really what it meant. And he said, and Peter stood up with the 11 till I came out, and then I heard a preacher preaching. And he was so annoyed that I wanted him to get and take one hag and let me have the other. Then the 11 was standing there waiting for their chance to preach. And they just got the Holy Ghost. And Peter was just coming in another minute, and they started already mentioning. So to let the mind will stir everything that can be stirred, and this is where the preacher needs to know, and he needs to be able to teach his congregation these possibilities of human spirit. I know a group of young people that get off plane on Sunday evening, and they just got the healing of everything they felt, and every one of them got demon possessed. They had to have the devils cast out of them. They did not know what to yield to. So they got the healing of everything, and the devil saw their weaknesses, and then he came and took over. And oh, God be merciful, knowing their condition, deliver them. But then it's got to yield to the Lord's Spirit. That's why the Bible said, try the spirits to see if they be of God.
How can you try the spirits to see if they be of God if you're not experienced? I mean, different spirits come out. Like, one of the spirits in the Adam and Eve comment would be even the family be able to get spirits affecting the same spirit, you know, trying to.
That's the spirit of your knowledge of the word, Brother John. The spirit will never come with the word. In other words, if it's following an adverse order, what Paul taught, you just about figure that that's either human spirit or something else. Well, I would say the majority of the time, maybe 9/10 of the time, that it is human spirit and not the powers of darkness. I don't believe the devil came back. Whatever it is, they can't be saved. There's got to be conditions before he can do it. But the human spirit can.
How did these young people do it? What did they do to you or something? Or what?
I don't really know. There must have been, there had to be some type of awakening done in their hearts or something. Possibly seeing, you know, I don't really know. They just see the gun thing and got wild and did not try to control themselves. And probably it could have gone into a pool, which is very dangerous, and naturally that opens a door. If you're going to pull on anything, you know, be hypocritical, you're opening a door for Satan to come in. That's why the old time preachers, old Bob Sherrill, I remember calling him in the hospital room. She did a lot of messing one night. He stopped her. He said, "Now look, here's where God stopped, and here's where you started." And she admitted it. She said, "Well, it didn't make sense." So I wanted it to make sense, so she added the words. He said, "God didn't call me to make sense." And he said, "Now look, if you do this again, operate in the carnal, I want you to get your suitcase and go home. We're not going to have this in our life." That's how severe the world, and that's why the very prophet of prophets was asking the millions, because they knew somebody to get into it. You know, so much discernment, you know, and knowledge of God, that maybe they were trying to operate in the flesh. I don't mean to stop.
But do you expect a young preacher, isn't there anything to start taking the spirit?
Well, until you know you may not prove it. Not prove it in spirits. Hardly to think that you feel the same way as you are not. Until you know what you're doing. And then they're going to need to know if you need time, because they're going to arrive at home. They can be extremely, extremely dangerous. You know, David?
Have you ever encountered such a thing as two people serve? Two people supposedly are seemingly arguing amongst themselves in tongues?
Well, I encountered it in Jamaica when I had a car. 2 hours has gotten flesh, there was. In fact, they found me hitting
one another. Well, I think it happened when I was in the business. It was going on, and it was two people getting in my husband. Well, what would you really thought you didn't really have to do? And then the spirit went for a while, she could assume the other space, and then we would go back, and then after a while, we finally left there and went down to the audience and pointed out the symbol. And she was just in the audience, so to speak, or just wrapping a bunch of something on the middle of one another.
Well, a lot of times the spirit will speak, rebuking in the tongues. But, maybe to an individual, it's an audience.
Have you ever encountered this experience of being in the meeting where Christ has went forth and someone being in the meeting that could understand that comment?
This happened to me one night in Irving, Texas. I wasn't even giving out the message. I just felt the anointing while I was preaching and stopped and talked and tended with me. The man came up and said, "Well, you speak Spanish, do you?" I said, "No, sir, I don't understand. I haven't even learned Acts 2:38. I know that now in Spanish, but I didn't know that then." I said, "No, I don't know anything about Spanish." And he told me what to say. This happens pretty often. You find a witness in any religion. This happens in foreign fields when people are getting the Holy Ghost. A lot of times they speak English.
Things that you don't even know about in tongues, when you pray in tongues. You're not always getting the blessing. You're actually praying. You're asking for things. And so this has been a great mistake that some have made. They go to talking in tongues immediately. They turn themselves to a blessing. And really, they should hold them because they are miraculously in the Spirit asking God for things. Or they could be fighting spiritual battles. I have literally rebuked the devil in tongues. I could tell by the tone that I was. And even the Spirit was revealed to me that I was. I knew what I was saying to him, but I was rebuking him in tongues. Now, I'm very anxious to get into the gifts of the Spirit, and I'd really like to give some of these other preliminary subjects on the line, not that they're not important. But I'd like for us, our minds, to be undivided in the gifts of the Spirit. I certainly don't want you to think that I claim to be the expert on the gifts of the Spirit, but I would at least like to share with you what I know about. And maybe all of us together can come up with some good, solid, concrete ideas on the gifts of the Spirit. And they're working, and they need to be working. If anybody has told you that we are all in the gifts of the Spirit, they're saying man's all out of mind. They're saying man can do as much without 2 feet. They're saying man can be as successful without his hands. The Scripture teaches very plainly that these gifts are put in the church as eyes and arms and hands and tools to where the body of Christ is perfected. The full stature of the man in Christ Jesus. I do not believe the church is perfect without the gifts of the Spirit. It will go very well to perfect it. It's not perfect after we got the gifts, but it's certainly not perfect before. And there is a teaching in the land that churches when they mature don't need the gifts anymore. But that is totally unscriptural. I cannot believe that, not for a moment, can I believe. And I believe that it is an essential thing that we have the gifts of the Spirit. And the more we come to the end of this journey, the more you're going to have to have them. If you cope with the Spirit of this age, you're going to match it, and you're going to be more than a conqueror because you have indulged into the spiritual realm in a greater measure. I contend with the apostles and the other churches and all of their deliverances. And all of their success is attributed to the Holy Ghost and its different administration and workings. And I feel we're going to have to return to that. It's very possible that they will arrive in their lives, in mine and your day. It's very possible that we could not get a lawyer to defend us. What lawyer defended Paul and Silas? It was the workings of the Holy Ghost. And it's very possible that you and I, right here, we'll be resurrected. Somebody starts pressing about our knowledge, but we will be listening. Right here, he just pains about in court, and we will lose. Determined by the success of a common man, maybe that shot himself. But I personally feel the day will arrive when we'll have less of that to begin with. God's going to force us. In my opinion, to reach for him more and more within his spirit, more and more as we go. And that's why I'd like to be ready for it. I'd like to be prepared. I'd be certain of that. Let's
get some of these out of the way, and in the next night or two, we'll go into. By the way, in a minute, Jim Davis from California will be here in the trial available to talk to you. He does some use of the Spirit. He's been in the ministry a long time, and I'm sure he could share some real good ideas with you. And since I'm having to house him, I'm going to take advantage of him and make him talk to us if I possibly can. And I think he would enjoy it.
What about the preliminaries of the service?
Let's go back into that just a little bit more. The importance of it. And how we can assist in bringing the minds of the people into the channel that God has told you that He wants to serve His hand. You remember us discussing some of those points. Let's go back over them just for a little bit here tonight, because we've been out a week without discussing these subjects, and I certainly want to tie back into them. And I mentioned to you the very important part, just as much as it's important for you to know the channel, it's just as important for you to be able to transfer this knowledge you have of the Word of God for that service to the minds of people. Or in other words, to get me into the channel of thinking that the Holy Ghost is leading you. And we discussed the points, some of the ways to do that. Of course, as we know, is a good way. Elisha sat down the minister and played it. And after they had played it, the inspiration came and he got a word from God. And not only is it necessary and valuable that you have courses or other means to get the minds of the people in the right channel, but let's say you don't know the will of God. You haven't found it yet. Many times have I sown courses, taught, used illustrations, past experiences to create an atmosphere that maybe what I'm saying is not even going to fit the ultimate will of God in that service. But at least it's creating an atmosphere that I can find the will of God. Now, I wish that I could tell you that every time you get up there that the service has already been a success as far as the preliminaries. What would be the problem? We could cut about half of this teaching off, because you wouldn't have much of a problem. If the church knew how to move into the area of the preliminaries and really worship, bring the power of God like it ought to, if you were anywhere near in contact with God, you'd find the will of God without any trouble. But I just have to say that 80% of the time, they didn't do that for me. I had to go up there still confused. You can always get in with you, and you're trying to prove my enemy. But there had never been enough spirit flowing in the preliminaries for me to even know yet what is God in the service. So now what do you do? The preliminaries is over. It's in your hands. You may have to start another preliminary service. And don't ever feel embarrassed. Don't ever feel like, well, man, I'm close to going to preach now. When I went to that pulpit, I want to know I've got to live and do whatever needs to be done to find God if I haven't already found Him. And if I have actually literally started service over again. Tell them he's done it. Let's start church now. He says, you don't do that overnight because that's somebody insulting. And you need to go in a manner that would not totally reflect against you, the pastor you're preaching for. But several times, and I hate to say this, but many times a pastor doesn't know himself how to follow God. In detail is what we're talking about. Now, I know this tape's going out all over the country, I guess, but that's the truth. It is well faced. I've been in churches where the man just stumbled over it. And this is one of the reasons created such a desire in my heart, what more I knew about it, to try to transfer it to somebody. And I'm not even with this. Older preachers. So I just have been used to the old form, and as a result, they did not know how to help you find the will of God. All they knew was three songs, testimony, offering, and came to you. And they didn't know how to push for you. They didn't know how to create atmosphere. They didn't know how to create channels, open the channels for you.
So I told him for Sunday to come, I had to go to the pulpit still not knowing what I was going to do. There wasn't enough Holy Ghost there for me to find the channel. So I've got to create it now. I've got to be able to know how to capture the minds of the people. And I tell you another problem you run into. When saints learn that you do this, you almost spoil them. I've had pastors say, "Well, will you take it as quick as possible, because they're not going to do anything until you get up here anyway." Because they learn that, well, here's the pastor saying the fast, and they got to get up and sing the Lord. And then on the next night, the pastor gets up and sings the Lord, and I get up and sing the fast. And so it creates a problem sometimes. It seems it's just simply waiting. Well, I might as well wait till he gets up here anyhow, because anything you do may not fit anyhow. So you've got that problem. So be prepared to connect your own local enemies. The main purpose of it is to get the Spirit flowing, as in the case of Elisha, until the voice of God can be heard.
Michael? What do you mean by
creating
that spirit?
Would
you go
with
that
again? Well, Brother Michael, let's say that you have found the channel, one of these channels, by which the Spirit generally flows in a message. Let's take that for example. There's many other areas to cover. But to be able to clearly explain it, if you understand it in our dealing with the five channels that God usually uses you with messages, then the other will also come natural. Let's say that you have found the channel tonight to be judgment to the sinner. Let's do it. Now, majority of the time, I felt the spirit of the message before I ever got the message. Now, after I got the channel, I've got to find which message fits that channel. I may have 15 sermons on judgment for the saint. But I've got to find one of those 15 fits that service, that one service. Now, let's say I found the channel. It's judgment to the saint tonight. Burden, I'm bursting inside. Man, my heart's about to kill me. I feel a fire burning me. Judgment to the sinner. Remember, the saints have been shouting. And a wicked was sat there while saints shouted, and the more they shouted, the greater burden built up in me. So use the anointing. Use whatever they're creating to help you build in you what the will of God is. Now, this is one reason I never did participate all that much in preliminaries. Because if I take down the word of shouting women, then I've got to regather myself. Now, others may do it different. In fact, I've seen others do it different. I've seen others that really got in there going in this worship women. But now, I couldn't do that. Whatever they were doing, I absorbed it to help me find the perfect will of God for my part of the service. See, the Holy Ghost can be used. Whatever form it falls in, are you all understanding me and I'm making myself clear on that point? Whatever form the Holy Ghost falls in can be used. Just like the power of God can fall in that, one may shout, and then they get to healing. It was the same Holy Ghost that fell. Another may get an answer to a problem. So what I'm saying, here they are shouting, but I'm using that power that's present. I don't mind that shouting. But it's completely opposite to what I feel. I'm using that spirit that's on them to blow up the word of God in my heart. Now I find it. It's there. I know it's going to be judgment to the sinner. They've been shouting. If I'm going to get the right kind of results, I've got to have those saints with me. Because God works through the church. He doesn't bypass it. That's why saying the church is so important to get it out. And by the way, I really mentioned this on my list. The cleansing of the church. Let's not forget that. I really mean to go into that. Now, that church has got to be with me if I'm going to really get results. And after all, man, that's all we're after. Not preach great sermons. We want results. Souls are at stake.
I can miss God and soul be lost. No doubt I've done it. There may be souls in hell right now. And I just stumble over the way of God. That's how serious it is to me. Now, look at that, I can screw it down tight in your heart, like I feel it tonight. If I miss God, I stand the chance of causing someone to be lost. Now, the only way I can have any results is have that truth with me. If no man is leading me in a channel of blessing, that's fine until I get up there. If God's told me that there's going to be judgment to the sinner, I need that church to think with me in that channel. I need that church to follow me in that channel. I need some support. I need them praying for me. In fact, I need them to share the burden of it. So, for me to get them there, I must create an atmosphere, or that's just a term I'm using. Get them thinking in the same channel that God has told you His will is. How do I do that? Well, of course you can do it. Telling past experiences in connection with this particular thought. It's pretty new. A lot of times I just acknowledge what I feel. Saints, I'm a human feeler tonight. Somebody is a sinner. Some sinner given me is on dangerous ground. Well, if those saints have any confidence in me at all, immediately they're going to start sharing that burden with me. I haven't preached. I don't want to preach yet. I'm pulling them in so they can help me. If I'm going to start off preaching, and I haven't got them already in the right atmosphere, it may take them halfway through my sermon to get there. But what's that done to my message? It's like a short of those electrical lines. I'm not getting a full hour or the full assistance and help from the church, from the body. So when I say create an atmosphere, I'm really saying get them thinking with you. Now, this is not, even though it is classed as psychology, it is not an act of psychology on my part. It's the fact that I'm trying to get them not only thinking, but feeling the spirit of it. I'm not really feeling. Because they may have been just shouting up stones. Well, they hadn't thought of a sinner. I'm just thinking, how many more rounds can I make around this church tonight?
Brother, do you recognize the possibility that you could be out of the game?
Always.
And if you try to pull it, say you got a message for judgment, you don't feel good, and they're shouting, well, that might be what God wants to do, and if you didn't get in, you'd be stuck.
Right. That's why you got to get yourself fixed, as you understand to your while I'm sitting there, I might go down another channel. In fact, I do. I don't pay any attention. Necessarily. I don't want that to be total because I know sometimes I'm going to shout through the whole church. That's all I do. But you know how I generally feel when that's true? I generally feel like participating in it. The Holy Ghost will turn me loose and allow me to get right in there, and that helps even make it greater. But you can just about figure it out. He's going to. When the Holy Ghost allows me to participate in the preliminaries, this may not work with you, which is how it works with me. And just about figure that's what's going to go forward to the end of the service. But my feelers are on, and I'm checking every channel. And so when I check on, let's say, they're shouting, and I check on shouting, because God wants that to continue. And I'll go down that road a little bit, and I might even think of messages that would encourage shouting. All of a sudden, some sounds, I back up, start down that road. And I'm doing this thing in the preliminaries. This is why I was allowed to participate. I'm preaching sermons. I preach 15, 20 sermons in part, you might say, before I ever get up to the chicken, trying the spirits to see if they need God. And when I get a message and it brings me, I get a name and it brings me, I get a name and it brings me, I just about forget it all. And I can never latch on to a message. And just about figure God's got something else in store for that service, for that sermon. Always conscious that you could fail and miss God. You're sensitive. But of all people that shouldn't know, it should be us. And that's what we're standing for.
Who is the leader of the message again?
Sir?
Who is the message is leading you again?
If I'm checking these messages out, it didn't make any difference what channel I am. In the back of my mind, I say, Brother Michael, I feel like I may preach this message. It's in my mind. Maybe a message I've already preached, maybe a new one I haven't preached. That's immaterial, but I'm thinking of a message, and I think I'm going to preach this tonight. Always with a reserve that God can change. Okay? I'm latched on to it. I feel like maybe this is it. All of a sudden, it leaves me. The interest in it is gone. Any feeling I had toward it died. And another one bobbed up, more interesting and more stirring to me and more enticing with more feeling. You know what I'm talking about when you feel a message? Well, that feeling dies. And another one pops up. I think, well, okay, I missed it. I'll do this one. And all of a sudden, it died. When this starts happening to me, I just about plan on it. In fact, I don't ever remember a time that that happened that I actually preached a message. And that, I don't want that to sound confusing with my checking these channels out. If it is, y'all speak up so I can go back through it. In other words, let me say it this way. As I said previously, when I'm going to preach, I check the channels by which he's going to use me tonight. Whether it's judgment to the sinner, whether it is faith building, uplifting to the saints, whether it's correction, instruction to the saints, whether it's a doctrinal message, or whether it's love message to the sinner. All right? Generally, the Spirit will let me know the spirit of the message before I ever know the message I'm going to preach. Now, when this spirit latches on me, when I feel it, and I've checked all the others out, and I feel this one, and it hangs and it lingers. Now, it's left up to me. I've eliminated the other ones. I feel this one. Now, I checked them all out, and they didn't last. They died. None of them felt right, but this channel. Let's say it's love, message to the sinner. Calvary type sermon. Now I've got to find the sermon that fits that channel. Okay, I start checking thoughts that I've previously preached or new ones that I've received on this subject. Never do I get in the pulpit. I'd say maybe twice a year do I ever know ahead of time what I'm going to preach. And when I get up there, I've got maybe between one or two minutes simmered down. And as I talk a little bit, all of a sudden it latches on the one. I feel it. That's it. Now, while I'm talking to them, I'm still thinking about sermons. Now, however you do that, I don't know how to tell you, but that's the way I had to do it. It was going to drive you crazy until you learn. And I don't want to make it sound complicated, but man, it's worth it. It's worth it if you have a nervous breakdown every 6 months. To know God in that service and follow His will and get results. It's worth it. Now, back to the point of checking these messages out and then leaving you. This is no contradiction to what I just said. You see, the thing I'm saying is I may check a channel and feel a net drop, check another net drop. I can't get settled in none of them. I may go back to the first one. Generally, then, I'm not going to preach at all. When I'm going to preach, the Holy Ghost generally lets me feel the spirit of the message and lets it stay with me till I get up there. I'd say 98% at least percent of the time,
when there was going to be a message, I found the channel and I felt it even before I got up there, and it stayed with me even after getting up there. But now the message, a lot of times I don't know it till I'm up there talking. But I've already felt the channel and I already know where I'm going. Now, if, as I say, all of this may work different with you, with this exception, God's going to use you in one of these channels. And He's going to use a specific message in those channels. Now, however you find that may be different than the way I find it. Some folks go out during the day and pray and God gives them a message that morning for that night. Now, that's the simple way. Good. If you can get it that way, just say, God, let it go this way for me. I like this better. Because it wouldn't work that way. It never did. Somebody, see, who was talking to me here the other day? Oh, yeah. Brother Green, I believe it was. Lee was asking about it. He said, God will show him maybe a day or two beforehand what's going to happen in the next service. And he so anxiously waits that and plans it so that by the time he gets there to it, he almost hinders it. And I believe that's the reason God withholds it from me. He knows my impatience. And He knows how I plan on things. I like to pre-plan everything I do. And by the time I pre-planned it, I probably got it so messed up that God couldn't use it in here. So He just says, I ain't going to show Him till the time I get ready to use it. And besides that, if you know it early in the morning, you'll carry it all day long and be wore out by that night. And so exhausted mentally that you won't be as accurate in the spirit. I've learned this. Let's say I get up in the morning. This may not be on this subject, I don't know, but I believe it's important for you. I learned this. Say I get up in the morning and a burden's on me. I don't know what I'm going to preach that night or whether I'm going to preach, but a burden's on me for that service that night. I just feel heavy. I feel a burden. Well, I'll pray and pray me, but I do my best to shake that burden, man, until about 5 o'clock. I used to think I was running guilty if I did that. But I learned if I'll get my mind off of that, it'll come back. About 5 o'clock, that thing will start settling then. And by church time, you're fresh, your mind's fresh, and the burden is actually heavier than if you'd have carried it all day long. Man, you can carry it till you get weary with it, and by that night you're not sharp enough to do what God wanted you to do. So actually, I've learned not to be foolish, not to be carnal, but to literally get it out of my mind. I read a newspaper, or I'll get something else on my mind purposely. So that thing will wait, late in the evening. Then I start pushing everything aside. Wife, babies, everything else. And Mr., don't bother me, and the thing's coming back on me. And I found out it would come on me heavier to wait than to carry it all along. Now, I believe you'll learn that's not just happening to one man, but that men have learned to do that. And that's what you'll feel guilty. Say, my Lord, I'm not even, here I am wanting to shirk my burden. No, you're not doing that. That's not your purpose. You just want to be rested enough to be able to carry it. You'll come back. If it's that heavy, remember, if you haven't been too carnal, it'll come back. All right. Any other questions along the way?
Brother Bean, since we're young in ministry and everything, you were talking about, a lot of times you have an approach that you haven't got the slightest idea what you're going to do already. Be kind of hard for us really, but I mean, how would we go about that? I mean, everybody's going to be hollering, like you said, they're going to be hollering to preach, and then they're going to be thinking, well, here he is, having preached 10 sermons in his whole life, and what do you think he is? And that's what I'm telling them, what to do.
So, all right, get your Bible. Yeah. In the first chapter of the book of Jeremiah. Thank you. start reading, let's see, I don't know what verse it is now. This is the complex of every young man. I thought it when I started out so bad that I couldn't even look at the altar. They said all they could see was the white of my eyes, looking up at the ceiling. Then the word of the Lord came to me, saying, before I formed thee in the belly, I knew thee, and before thou camest forth out of the womb, I sanctified thee, and I ordained thee a prophet unto the nations. Then said I, O Lord God, behold, I cannot speak, for I'm a child. The Lord said unto me, say not I'm a child, for thou shalt go to all that I shall send thee. And whatsoever I command thee, thou shalt speak. Be not afraid of their faces, for I am with thee to deliver thee, saith the Lord. Then the Lord put forth his hand and touched my mouth. And the Lord said unto me, behold, I put my words in thy mouth. See, I have this day set thee over the nations and over the kingdoms to root out, to pull down, to destroy, to pull down, to build and to plant. I fought that devil. Man, I fought him. You little old young fellow, who are you up here telling these old heads what to do? You see them old gray heads sitting out there, and I've always been taught to respect age, and I still do. But when I stand before God, I was called and ordained for my mother womb to be a preacher. Now, Lord, I pray today. I haven't been foolish. I haven't fooled around. If you want to be really confounded before them, go uptown, spend the day uptown all day, gallivanting around and carrying on, and then you'll be in a mess. But when you know you walk before God that day, believe God's going to show you what to do. I don't know now, saints. I tell them that. That's nothing. Saints, I don't know what God wants, but there's something He wants here tonight. I sure don't feel that it's a message. I found out saints appreciate good, down-to-earth honesty. They know that you're human. On the other hand, after you've waited on God a while and they've seen the move of God, here's the thing. Have something good to say even while you're waiting on God. This amen, hallelujah, God, amen, hallelujah, God, that's not it. Even though you're not preaching, have something that they will feed on. Now, I'm not boasting. Please believe me when I say this, but I've heard preachers come to my defense. It's been told all over the country that I never preached. Well, the man that I've had has come to my defense, and I've heard him. Said, well, he preaches. He just doesn't pick a text. In between shouts, he preaches sermons that is valuable. Well, I always, whenever I say something, I want to have something to say. Now, this comes by study. This comes by learning. In other words, study to shew thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed. Now, if I'm standing there and I know I'm not going to preach, or at least I feel like I'm not, and I'm trying to find the channel, let's say the channel tonight, God's fixing to break loose a bunch of old dead heads that haven't shouted. Now, I'm waiting on that move of God. Well, until it comes, and I'm leaning that direction. Maybe that's not the perfect way, but at least I'm leaning that direction. I'm going to be quoting scriptures that will encourage them to shout. On the subject of worship, have you a bunch of scriptures? And after a while, you'll have some experiences you can add to that. You understand? For instance, I'm doing many times, but the old girl in one place says, I'm not a shout. And I said, yes, you are. God don't see to it that you shout. Whether you want to or not, He's going to make you shout for me. Well, sure enough, one night she's sitting on the second bench, and power of God got on me, and I went down where she sat and waved my handkerchief over her head. God hit her and she jumped up and squealed like a Comanche Indian. Now, a few experiences like that help bring to their minds what you're talking about. And that's nothing wrong with telling the experience. God for your knowledge on any of these subjects, such as worship, prayer. Let's say tonight you feel it going towards prayer. Well, you need to have, even if you're not going to preach, you need to be quoting scriptures on prayer or telling experiences on prayer. Have something to back up what God is wanting to do. Or if you don't know at all what direction, at least talk to them something they'll enjoy hearing, something with sense to it. You know? Because after a while they get tired of it, he said, hallelujah, glory God, amen, praise God, amen, hallelujah now. I have done my very best and practiced not to use helpers in my preaching. And sometimes I'll do it, but when I catch myself doing it very often, I say, boy, you're not going to do that anymore. Let's go ahead and say what needs to be said without amen, hallelujah, or go to God, or fill in words. People get worried with that. Catch yourself. I tell you, one of the best places every preacher ought to hear himself about every few weeks on the tape and see just what he's doing and learn from it. And omit some of this unnecessary stuff. And I was talking to Brother Mayo got really annoyed the other night at the Tyler. Man, I'm telling you, he's just annoyed. And I got talking to him about it, but he went over the anointing. He still felt good, but the anointing left him. The Brother Mayo, he's a pick on, that's why we all pick him. In fact, Brother Duke Place to him, Brother the pastor up there, James Romney Bull, is telling on Brother Mayo about why he was so anointed, brother. I just told Brother James Romney about his ordeal there at Evans. And Brother Duke Bishop told about him riding the plane up there and having a handful of plane on either side. So he was really afraid too the time he got to that. But here's what I'm saying. I'm not picking on anybody. We're here to learn and to do it. I mean, all of us have done this. I've done it. I still do it, Brother Mayo. In spite of myself, I still do it. But what I'm saying, for a young man, it'll be best you leave the audience wanting to hear more than to go over the anointing. Because they don't believe you've got that much to say. In spite of all you've got to say, they don't believe that. In other words, what I'm saying is a young man should try to not preach as long. Now, I've not been an example, and I realize that I'm a poor teacher along that line. I preach too long on too many times. But I know what I'm talking about. If you leave them still wanting to hear you, and Brother Mayo didn't go that far over, but I mean, he was really red hot anointed. Everybody felt the vibration of it, and then it began to simmer down. Well, if he could have left it at that peak, then every time he went to fellowship meeting, they'd be waiting for him to get up there. But you can talk away the anointing. I've seen the time when the conviction was preached off. Preached on, preached off. And my wife's grandfather was a long-winded preacher, I think, as high as 4 hours sometimes. And my father-in-law was telling me, said, I've seen him preach the conviction on the sinner, preach it off, and preach it back on. Well, you can do that. You can actually go to the point that if you close it right then, don't go beyond that. You're still feeling it and enjoying it. But if you could just learn while it's still on you, that won't just come back. Yeah. That wasn't too important, but I just want to drop that in there. But as a young man, if God's called you, don't worry about their faces or what they think. You're going to be, before you get out of this room and go to the ministry, be delivered from people or you'll never follow the Holy Ghost. People's opinions can't mean a thing in the world to you. with this exception, you want them saved. You want them to believe in you. You want them to like you. Look like some folks, I preached for a man one time, and looked like trying to make people not like him. I had a couple of fellows mad at me because I was preaching the doctrine and they didn't like it. And they told him about it. Said, we like you, but boy, if I could get that fellow by the collar. Well, he got up the next night and brother, he took the service over trying to make them not like him. Well, you ought to have better sense. God uses a personality sometimes to win people. Don't try to make them dislike you, but be so delivered from them that you can obey the voice of God.
Well, being the biggest thing that actually I run into a lead singer in the church, and 9 times out of 10, you know, I've got some way to get some people before they can worship. And it never fails. Every time I get up there, they just sit there and look at them and sing and clap their hands and just worship. And you've got a
silly
bunch of people just
sat there.
You can't get them to do anything.
I tell you, if you ever develop a negative attitude and start rebuking them too much.
I don't ever tell them that, but it's
in the mind. Well, don't ever give to it. Unless it's really God. Because first thing you know, they'll get gun shy. And every time you get up there, they'll clamp up expecting you to hit them. Young men have really made mistakes like that. They go in this lambast and everybody backslid, you know. And the first thing you know, they say, well, wait a minute here now. I know I touched God today. You have to be careful on that line. But sometimes you feel like shaking them, literally. But you can't do it. You've got to do it. You've got to lead them. We're leaders in worship.
Is it wrong that I know sometimes I'm poor out here, pick out 4 or 5 songs and fix a set, and I get up there, I'll just play through those songs, and I might have a song that I want to start the song from a different one to end it with? Is it wrong? But this one here, kind of, it don't really get them shout, it don't really get them really going. But I didn't want to really get going on that. I could be wrong straightened out.
Now, in what capacity are you talking about, brother? As a pastor leading a service or as a song leader?
Pastor. Maybe I could be wrong. I know that here's the way I thought it pastor. I hope you don't misunderstand. But when I start the service off of this song, and my ultimate goal was after the song service. And I know it's during the song service something happened, we went to that. But I pointed towards right after the song service. You know, not necessarily preaching, but just right after the song service. And I blamed songs to work.
Let me say it this way, Brother Michael. If you know foreknow the will of God that far ahead, anything you do to prepare them for that is acceptable. You understand?
Yes.
There's not a thing more wrong with picking the songs that would fit the channel that you think it's going to finally fall into, or maybe the next channel. These services can take on several channels in one service. But the next channel, you take them a step at a time as God offers them, you plug into it. And if you foreknow it, anything you do to prepare their minds for it, such as the selecting of a song that would fit that. I've seen services totally erupted, destroyed, because the wrong song was picked at the wrong time. I was in a service one night, and God was my witness. While they were singing in the song service, this is one of those nights that I was allowed to participate. There was such a build-up of power and anointing that I couldn't sit down. I had to get up. Would you believe that the pastor got up just before he turned it to me and started singing, "There's a beautiful..." kill that service so dead that I never did get it back. Never did. Man, he was building up for that one. I mean, we was going in for a home run. And he killed it just as dead by singing the wrong song before I got it.
Well, let me ask you this. My first song, if I'm not really sure, I try to pick it gently.
That's all right. That's why. And a lot of times, let's say I'm standing up here, either as a pastor or evangelist, before the ministry of the word or whatever God's will is for tonight. I don't know his will, so I don't know which song to pick. I wouldn't know whether to lead them into faith or lead them into fear. So I pick a worship type song, general worship, to just get the spirit moving. That's the whole purpose of it. Then from there you begin to launch out into the areas. This can start at the song service itself also. And a lot of times I select my song leader song. For that reason, not that I don't trust her as a good woman to lead songs, but I just feel that this would be best to start it with. And it may be so general, may not be about to come to the Lord, just something to get them worshiping. Sometimes that's all you need, is to get people worshiping. And then the Spirit flows so heavy, you can find it then. Because after they're in the spirit of worship, if they're there, you can lead them most in the direction you want to go. I found that very simple. You can stop it and change gears altogether. The Lord tried to change it before there is what's the job. Get them to worship. However, and I would say the general type courses or songs is the best. And not only courses. The general type talking about God. General experiences. I don't know which direction I'm going. I don't know if it's going to be scary, blessed, joyous, whatever. What's going to wind up? I may just have experiences to get faith built up and get them to moving in the Spirit, worshiping the Lord, feeling after God. Nothing else making them hungry to have the same experience here. And first thing you know, they reach for God and got him flowing. You just can't imagine how valuable it is to get that church moving in and get them worship. That's the plan of God. It's the will of God. It's God's plan. If you feel that you can preach over them and around them, you're mistaken. As I said, I'd rather preach to 10,000 snuff dippers, whore mongers, thieves, robbers, than to preach to 3 unconsecrated, unconcerned saints. Because they can tie you up. They can bind the servant. The sinner can't, but a child of God can.
Why is that? I've been wondering if there was in the Bible saying something that the things of God or something inhabiting a controlling ministry that you can't preach.
It doesn't mean you can't do it. It will be hindered.
Well, yes. I didn't understand fully.
Simply because we're part of the body. And if your right arm's infected, it's going to slow your whole body down. And, I don't know, it just works that way. Now, that doesn't mean that saints control the ministry, but they certainly can drag or hinder. And that's why that I never could go into revival without first purging the church. Of course, if the Holy Ghost called for a weeping first, I've done that too, but before that church can be turned loose as in good shape, they're going to have to be responsive. They're going to have to learn to follow the ministry closer. Now, sinner has no connection with the body, therefore they can do no harm to you. Well, it's an amazing thing for the little sin in the heart of the saint or unconcerned or repenting to do the service. I've actually had services tied up because couples had fussed before church. I was tied up in one place, and oh, it was bound. I was searching for what the matter was, and the Holy Ghost spoke to me, said it's a family spirit and a family feud. So I told him, I said, somebody's fussed just before you came in church. I said, right now I want you to go straighten it out. Boy, here they started crossing that in my aisle, the daughters are repenting, the dad isn't. After they did, the spirit broke. Of course, there's many reasons why the Holy Ghost would do that. Number one, he teaches the rest of them to fear. And he teaches them not to do that no more. Now, not that that is the major thing to tie a service up. But when God's purging a church, he makes them tender to all these things by spotlighting them. You understand what I mean? I never forget one place I was at again. The service is tied up, and I said, there's somebody here having a fuss. I said, wave your hand. I said, and this poor little boy, he just prayed through, didn't everybody? Raise your hand. Well, his wife looked at him as though to say, huh, he must fell off on the. Well, don't do that unless you feel it. You know what's going to be a problem to you? Any teacher that teaches you, if you go and try to attain this, they're going to say, you know, there's another, you're trying to act like Brother Bean, or trying to act like Brother Free, or that's going to be a battle for you. But go on and obey God if you don't act like somebody else. Not that you're copying. I don't believe you men would do that on purpose. Because you've got your own identity. Find God like you can, but you're going to fight that battle. You as well get ready for it. But don't let it affect you. You go on and wait on the Holy Ghost. I've had a man say, well, little Brother Beans are trying to find the will of God tonight. Well, that, to me, that is so unkind and rude. You find God don't make no difference what they say or what you think they're saying. I've had them so mad at me till they could have choked me. But I just got to go and obey the Lord. Delivered from people and their opinion. You'll never be the preacher you're supposed to be till you get deliverance from people. If I be the servant of men, Paul said, how can I be the servant of God? I'm going to be men pleasers. I cannot please God. There's a thin line of being independent from people's wills and yet loving and caring for those same people. And when you learn to walk that tight rope, you're fixing to get results. Did you know the truth of the matter is they don't want you to give in to them? They'll respect you in the long run. Before it's all over with, they'll honor you far more for not giving in to their will and wishes. Old boy one time got so mad at me. I didn't know it, but him and his father-in-law would go home after church, and they'd talk about me some awful. Well, the Holy Ghost kept it from me. I didn't know anything about it. And one night I just looked back there, and the Spirit says, call him out and make him walk around by himself and praise God. I said, Brother so-and-so, get up by yourself and walk around here with your hands up praising the Lord. He was once so mad at me, he could have spit on me. And he said he almost refused. But God wouldn't let him. The anointing, there. The Bible said the yoke is broken because of the anointing. Men that are stubborn can bow if you've got enough power in your life. And that comes through prayer and fasting, saying before God. So he finally got up and started struggling around, rebellious really at heart. But he was a walker. After about the third round, the fire of God hit him. He got to rejoice. The blessing of the Lord came on him. And he told me, he said, I tried to pull my hand down. He said, it did like springs underneath him, and then go right back up. That's the best friend I've got today. He was so glad I did that. He told me later, said, I hated you. I talked about you. Every night we'd go home and that would be our subject. But after he got the deliverance, he was so carnal and bound But after he got deliverance, then he appreciated the man that would be bold enough and obey God enough to help deliver him. You can't see men after the flesh. Paul said, I see no man after the flesh. You don't see their anger. You don't see their unkindness. You see them in the finished product. Wait till this Holy Ghost gets through with you and you'll act different. You'll feel different. And if you don't have that in your mind, then you won't get to first base, because you're going to get in there and mix it with them. You'll be preaching at them when you're not supposed to preach at them. You'll spend a whole service shooting at one man if you're given to that, responding yourself to their feelings. Sometimes the Holy Ghost will let you shoot at one man, but you better be sure it's Holy Ghost and not you trying to get him. Don't ever take advantage of the pulpit to get out a man that you know that's against you. Unless God gives it to you, and I'd pray more over that message than I would over any of them. For fear it was just me wanting to get take advantage of the pulpit to get at him. Beat the whole church to get one man. Be bold enough to go to him and call him in the office, or whatever needs to be told to him individually. But don't whip the church every night just to get the one man, starving them to death while you're getting one fellow. You know a man in the Bible that did that? A man by the name of Haman. Got promoted next to the king, riding the king's horse, and forgot all of his honor and his power, and forgot the thousands that were already bowing. And he got his mind on one man, Mordecai. And lost the joy, lost the thrill of his promotion, and spent the rest of his life figuring out how he can kill that one man. And wound up killed on the gallows that he built to kill him. So don't spend your time shooting at one man unless the Holy Ghost can tell him. Well, I haven't got any more. I'd look kind of scatterbarrel tonight, but these points are valuable. They are really valuable, believe it or not. I will repeat again. Stand there and wait on God if it kills you. If you can't feel a message, you know. They'd come to me and laugh and say, well, Brother Bean didn't get any message, so he had a victory march. Well, a man that's conscientious, that hurts him. Man, I wasn't that playing. Every service is a serious one to me. So that really hurts you. I had the pastor I was preaching for so well. He couldn't get him one today, so he had a victory march. Use every tactic in the world to try to get you to preach every night. But you just go on praying fast, let the anointing be there, and wait on God. He'll see after a while. I had one old preacher got up during my revival and said, folks, I've learned a lesson of a lifetime. He said, many, many nights, the evenings, I've gone in that office back there and got a sermon when I didn't feel it, because I knew you wanted a sermon. And he said, I'd preach, and nothing would happen. But I watched Brother Bean when he don't have a message. He does something else. So that's what I ought to have been doing. I mean, this is a man that preached many, many years before I even got the Holy Ghost, I guess. He said, from here on out, when I don't feel a message, we're going to do something else. Now, if I would have conformed to the spirit of that church, that man would have never learned that lesson. And he needed to learn it. Because he had one of the daddy's churches, Pentecost. So before God got through the church, I told him, I said, you won't know it. In a direction you want them to go, well, they'll go when God gets through them. I said, man, I hope so. I haven't got an amen out of them since I'm in here, hardly. Well, man, before the Holy Ghost got through that bunch, you could sing a slow chorus and they'd squirrel like babies. Or you could sing a fast one and they'd shout to let them sing. And that's where people need to be. They need to be taught to be sensitive and quick to the Holy Ghost.
We do the same thing in the home church.
Yeah. But you remember this, a prophet's without honor, saving his own faith. You'll have a worse time looking at all.
Well, then, would you say that if you get up there and you don't say a word, but somehow you're afraid of them, maybe that you don't know what you're going to do, but you are capable and feel like you're going to do it. Maybe you just stand there and say 5 minutes, but they do feel like you're going somewhere. You may not know right then, but you're capable of going.
I've seen the time that silence did more than talking. I went to the pulpit, either so burdened or, like you say, maybe I didn't know. I felt God, but I didn't know what direction. And I just stand there for a while. But nothing draws their attention. And when you do come out with it, they're ready for it. First place, this has got to be, you might as well face it. This has got to be established. Confidence in your ability to follow God. And I don't care how old you get, going to a new church for the first week or two, you spend your time establishing their faith in your ability. And it's not your promoting yourself. You don't go there saying, what I can do. You just go ahead and do it, what you feel, and let the results follow. And first thing you know, they'll start believing in you. So don't be alarmed or shaken. I went to church when this was long after God had begun to use me in this area. I felt almost a veteran at it. But I walked in that church and, man, you're talking about Pastor told me, said, Brother Bean, I felt the sorry for they looked at me as though they expected me to come on the platform cutting flips or something. You know, they heard so many wild tales about me. Then there wasn't a human there believed in me, but the pastor and he wasn't shook. And it took me about 3 or 4 nights. I say the Holy Ghost does this for you. Now you follow God knows how to avenge you. You just follow God. You don't get up there bragging about yourself. You let God do the working. And here they started coming to me, my God, Brother Bean, forgive me. First night you came here, I doubted you. I don't know how many of them told me that. I said, now whatever you say, I believe it. Well, the Holy Ghost knows how to move in there, doesn't it? If you'll pray and fast and walk before God, God knows how to handle that.
Well, these folks are not knowing what they're doing in the pulpit. Well, to me, that scares me. I mean, all day long. I can't pray for what am I going to do? Well, maybe that poor thing out there don't know that. Go on, people, go on
ahead. Well, go back to the first chapter of Jeremiah and read it again. Be not dismayed at your faith. Another place he told the prophet, said, lest I confound you before. And he said, I'll make your forehead harder than theirs. Remember, you're hard-headed, more so than they are. Now, don't take that advantage of them because of it, but that means you're supposed to have a stronger will in there. That's just one place I was at. They screamed at me overnight, not audibly, but the Spirit preached. I only hear you. What they really wanted to do is compare me with other preachers they heard. I told them, I said, I know what you're doing. You're trying to compare me. But I said, you're not going to compare me with anybody. And I said, I'm not going to be the main actor in this show. Y'all going to be a part of it too. But I said, let's wait on God. And I started pleading with them. 9 o'clock, and they hadn't woke me yet. They were sitting there, I could hear them say, well, you know, you could just feel their spirit. Well, what in the world's the matter with this silly fellow? Didn't he pray today or... Well, we went to all the trouble to bring friends out here, and we are treated now to a display of the standing, staring. But I knew God wanted to do something. I finally closed my Bible on purpose. I wanted to see that I closed it and shoved it up to the top of the Bible. That's why we surrendered. I told him, I said, my head's hard to deal. tied down waiting. We're going to wait on the Lord today. And after a while, they recognize what I'm trying to do. And they turn to spit loose, and when they did, they altered line from thy will. There wasn't a sermon preached, there wasn't a song sung, there wasn't anything done except wait on the hungry when they turned him loose. And that church hadn't had a revival in years. And here it is lying from the Lord. Well, it didn't take, but it was about a week later. They tried it again on me, and all I had to do was remind them. Remember the other night when I asked you to wait on God? What happened? Did the altar fill out? And it didn't take but just a minute till they were ready to go with me.
But
we'll
never
have
to. Yes, you know, all these moments, you get to the right up to the pulpit. Like one spin and a half. And the whole service, the premier, and the final pathway to the
There's no spin and a half?
No, one spin and a half.
Well, that's a new terrible thing, Brother Mary. First of all, God knows.
Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and lean not into your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct your path. Baptism, then what? Baptism is a burial in water for accountable beings into the remission of sins, for salvation, to get into Christ, to become a new creature, to get into the one body. Then, walk in the new life, study and grow. Become a servant of righteousness. Keep self pure. Be an example. Have faith in God. Follow Jesus. Put first things first. Resist temptation. Be faithful. And be fruitful.
What we do in life echoes in eternity.
What we do in life. Echoes in eternity.